Welcome to Talk of the Bay. I'm Christine Barrington. All aboard! Well, today is the first in a series of stories I'm presenting on the Santa Cruz Rail and Trail. Now, is this a rail or is it a trail or is it both? Have you ever felt confused about the issue? Do you know what's going on? Why is it so contentious? Will we ever get a rail system? Should we? If so, how will we pay for it? And why is it taking so long? Do we really need another study? Well, if you have ever had these questions like I did, I hope by the end of this series, you will feel illuminated. Well, at least a little bit. Because it turns out that projects of this scale and complexity are epic, with champions and challengers, visionaries and volunteers, planners, policymakers, and politicians, and with so many studies and storylines, it makes the head spin. But what matters in the end is that the story of the rail and trail is largely about people. People who vote, people who plan, and people who politic. But most importantly, accomplishing large public works is about people who care and hold a vision for the greater good while also wielding serious governmental chops and the ability to think in decades. Throughout this series, we are going to meet a few of these people. Like the proverbial tip of the iceberg, the individuals who sat down with me are some of the most visible of the hundreds who have performed so much work below the waterline and often out of public perception. If the day ever comes when we can step out of a car and onto a platform or a finished rail trail, we will have so many people who are worthy of our thanks. It is my hope this series on the rail and trail will highlight some of them, honor the many we missed, and help clarify what the issues are so we can climb all aboard towards a vision of the future where everyone has real choices on how to get around our gorgeous region. So let's start at a beginning. I say a beginning because with the rail trail, there were many beginnings with many different leaders and community members all thinking about the possibilities of that rail line that runs along our oceanside. Now, this beginning is about three friends called Sam, Linda, and John. These friends are your friends too, whether you know it or not, because each of them have been serving the public for many decades. John Brissenden helped found Land Trust Santa Cruz. He co-founded our community foundation and the Life Lab program. Linda Wilcheson was a Santa Cruz transportation planner for decades and headed our Regional Transportation Commission from 1985 to 2005. And Sam, well, Sam Farr is a local hero in the hearts of many simply because he's done so much for the Monterey Bay region. A long time ago, these three all had a rail corridor on their mind. Let's meet John.
Back in the day, not longer after I left working for Congressman Leon Panetta, the former mayor of Santa Cruz, Norm Lezen, who also was the head of Sol's Tannery, asked if there was a way to get trucks off of Highway 17. So he engaged myself and my partner, Patrick Carlson, to look at ways to do that. And we explored several different approaches in terms of daisy days and different hours for truck traffic, etc. And one of the things we hit on was that there was an underutilized rail service in Santa Cruz. And so Norm knew of the work that we've been doing and involved with, and so he said, you guys are creative. Can you come up with a solution? So we interviewed some short line folks from the folks that owned the skunk train up in Fort Bragg, Willis Kyle. He was the same gentleman that owned the Red Line in San Diego, so he had some thoughts on rail back then. Can remember the guy distinctly. He was ran all these little short lines from a wheelchair. But he said, you know, the thing you have to do is buy the rail, and then you control the whole thing. So we threw that out to Norm and said, well, that's a big, big
That's what you got to do. That's all you got to do. Wow.
So that sort of began this windy story that's still not fully complete.
It's pretty epic. You and your partner are the sort of seed.
It was germinating for quite some time after that.
It was, yeah. but the seed.
Yeah,
and then it had to germinate, right? One,
yeah, I mean, it certainly needed
I see lots, modest,
lots
of course,
villagers
right,
to water
of
and,
course.
And
right.
you know, fend off predators. And
okay,
others.
So Willis said, you need to buy
Yeah,
the
you
whole
need
thing.
To buy that so you can control the future on that rail.
Okay, that makes sense. And so then what happened?
Then we worked on putting together the community foundation, which sort of took a little time. Anyway, so that, and we also decided to get married in that same time frame with my wife, who was Patty Coffey Johnson, and she was working for Sam Farr. And so we stepped off a major cliff and bought a resort for $1,500 in the High Sierra.
In the Sierras, that's right. I read that in your bio. So I just want to get this straight. You helped found the Santa Cruz Land Trust. You helped found the Community Foundation. You were on a school board, and you started getting gardens in the schools. You're very active and a very influential being in this region. And then you kind of took a hiatus for 39 years. Okay, great.
We're still involved here.
Okay.
Yeah, we mm-hmm. kept a home here, which is the only way we would have been able to come back.
Right,
so.
Right.
Yeah, so we had a resort called Sorensen's in Hope Valley. It did some work around there, which was conservation work, which tied into a bunch of the work we did here. So in the midst of all that, after working at the resort for nigh on to 13 years, we decided to take a year off and move to Washington, D.C., and where we helped Sam put his first congressional office together as volunteers. And then
okay.
he got us a job at the
wow.
White House, also as volunteers, to sort through the 80,000 pieces of mail that Clintons got every day. So we were in the midst of a crazy year. So in that, Linda and Rock came back. Linda Wilshes and Rock Fotenauer came back to visit for a week. And during that time, we had a hearing at the Transportation Committee, House of Representatives, that Sam had submitted a plea for a $1.6 million grant to do some of the planning for the rail and trail. So that's where much of the impetus got restarted. And
what year was that? That was in
94, I believe. So on our way to the hearing, we went to the train station and picked up some whistles for the Transportation Committee and handed out transportation train whistles and railroad ties, silk railroad ties,
right.
to
okay.
influence their vote on this okay. grant.
Not big money lobbyists, but wonderful symbolists.
No, no.
Okay.
All under probably symbolism. $200.
Perfect.
And here's Congressman Sam Farr with a curiously similar tale.
You know, I got interested in this issue when I went to Washington, and there the program was being initiated on rail trail funding. In those days, railroads were starting to abandon rail lines, and local communities wanted to save the corridors for transportation purposes, and therefore the concept of using rail lines for trails and funding set aside for that. So how I got involved is that when I campaigned for elective office, both for the legislature and for Congress, you know, friends came to help me. And one of those friends was John Brisden, whose wife, Patty, worked for me in my office when I was in the assembly. She was in my Santa Cruz office. So I got to know John and Patty pretty well. And Linda Wilson, who was on the transportation board at the time, and both Linda and John came back to Washington. And I was just a newly elected congressman, and they lobbied me to get some money for a planning grant for Santa Cruz. I think it was about $1.6 million to fund the planning of the rail trail system. And I remember a cute little story is I took them to dinner at the Union Station, the multimodal transportation center in Washington, where all the trains, buses, and subways come. And there was we had dinner there, and it's a great spot. It's a really you know, for all kinds of reasons. But anyway, they had a cute little store there that sold items like interest in trails, I mean, in rails. And so we bought those wooden whistles that trains make, and we bought some neckties that had railroads all over them. And we appeared the next day before Norm Mineta, who was chair of the Transportation Committee at the time in Congress, and handed out the whistles to everybody, and they got a kick out of that. And we got the $1.6 million planning grant. So that's how it got started.
So this was 1994, when our three friends, Sam, John, and Linda, lobbied Congress the Santa Cruz way, not with big money, but with big symbols and big ideas. Now, let's meet Linda Wilsheson. By this time in 1994, she had been thinking about the rail corridor for quite some time. Wait, just a second. Sam Farr wants to say something about Linda.
Well, she's the goddess of rail trail lobbying, I'll tell you. She's just been phenomenal. I got to know her because she volunteered to walk precincts with me. We always kid because she was pregnant, and so a lot of people went knocking on doors together because I didn't know Santa Cruz that well, and from being my background on the Monterey Peninsula, and we always joked because people thought, oh, is she your wife? I said, no. Well, they were wondering why I was walking with a pregnant lady, but anyway, we laugh about it. But we got to know each other in those campaign years and have remained friends ever since.
Clearly, these public servants go way back, and Linda's history in transportation planning goes way back too.
My name is Linda Wilsheson, and I started at the Transportation Commission, which at that time didn't have the regional as part of the title. We added that later because that's really what we were doing. In 1974, I was a student worker. I had just taken a map class in the drafting department at Cabrillo College, and I loved working with maps. And of course, a lot of what you do with maps, unless you're a geography student, which I kind of wish I had been at UCSC, but it wasn't really on my radar. I graduated in anthropology in 1972 from the relatively new university. I looked at maps of roads like we all did. So that was my experience to get this job. The RTC, now what people think of as the RTC, the Regional Transportation Commission, had started in 1972. So I was, there pretty early at the lowest level and worked on the first regional transportation plan that was developed in 1975. Then I ended up working on other land use issues there. I stayed there till 1978. We had our daughters, and I worked as a consultant and then came back to the RTC in 1985 and left there in 2005.
Yes, and when you came in 1985, you were at the head. You were the executive director of our Regional Transportation Commission.
I was 35 years old. I didn't really know what I was doing.
And so we have started our little bit of history on the theme of friendship and how relationships are often the secret sauce that gets projects moving. But the superpower behind transportation projects are planners who, like those gods with many hands and eyes, use their intellect and imagination to anticipate traffic patterns and problems so as to design our future movements, all the while juggling public policy, tricky laws, and concerned citizens. Yes, planners are thinkers. They think long and they think deep. Here's Linda Wilsheson on some of the foundational thinking related to uses for the Santa Cruz Rail Corridor.
I think I'd like to just start with getting us grounded in geography, because geography and the way our county has developed, we're a small population, 250,000 people, and growing and popular as a tourist destination. And in fact, the location of the rail line determined a lot of where people lived along the coast and was very instrumental in developing the tourist economy since almost 150 years or so. But our urbanized development, and we do have a quite dense development, similar to the Bay Area. We don't think of ourselves that way because we're kind of isolated from the Bay Area, by the Santa Cruz Mountains. And then parts of our community are in the South County, more focused in the agricultural, history there. And then the San Lorenzo Valley has its own history. But the coastal area is about, 150,000 people. But we don't think of ourselves as a common city. We think of ourselves as Aptos or Soquel or Capitola or Live Oak or Santa Cruz. Santa Cruz, of course, is the dominant one. But that has really led to some of the problems we've had over time that I see in difficulties in reaching consensus on what we should be doing in our area that the rail line traverses, and of course the area that Highway 1 provides, our main transportation corridor. So what do we do with these? And when I came, there was starting to be recognition that we can't build our way out of it. both at the state and the federal level. I mean, everybody was starting to realize that, you know.
And when you say build our way out of it, what does that mean?
Build our way out of traffic congestion. In other words, we can't just keep adding lanes. Well, certainly we're constrained here on Highway 1 in Santa Cruz County, but, you know, everywhere else has the same problem.
And yes, somebody along the way in this journey said to me, if highway widening were L.A., would not have traffic problems.
Well, or the Bay Area.
Or the Bay Area.
You know, when you... Yeah, I don't even want to talk
don't go
about
there.
The Bay Area. No, but we are part of the Bay Area, and we're actually heading more in that direction. So yeah. It's a difficult challenge when people are very dependent on their cars and don't have other options. So when you have a rail line that ended up being for sale that runs along the same corridor parallel to your highway... And actually, the development that's happened in the area is around that rail line because it preceded the highway and actually preceded cars, as people know. You do start thinking about it. You start thinking, can we use this for transportation? And so for me, for somebody who would think about this all the time, it was a no-brainer, and not just for me. It's certainly for other people. The line is in the California Rail Plan. I mean, we're not the only ones who have thought about this or dreamed this idea up.
Hearing Linda start with geography made me reflect on the words of public transit consultant Jeff Booth, who participated in a coastal rail forum here in Santa Cruz in 2018.
You have a very unique corridor, and I say that not in a negative way, actually an incredibly positive way, because when Bruce took me on the corridor, I'm struck at a substantial part of the corridor. You already have density. You already have development on the corridor. And so many other places use the projects to sort of create nodes of development and use it as an economic development tool to sort of shape development in their region or to shape development in the corridor. You already got development in the corridor, and you actually have a lot of little... I don't know what you call it, villages or little places where there's commercial activity at potential rail stations that's already there. A lot of other places would try to use the station to generate that kind of development. You already have it there. So the fact is, for much of the sort of densely part of the corridor, you already have development, you already have density that a lot of cities would kill for. And you already have so many people that live so close to the line, you're going to have a lot of walk-up transit, people who live in the corridor are simply going to walk or bike to the line because of their proximity to that line. And so I think that really makes this project really unique compared to a lot of the other corridors that I've been involved in, where they don't have that kind of the kind of alignment that you have right now.
In case you have just tuned in, you are listening to KSQD Community Radio for the Monterey Bay. I'm Christine Barrington. This is the first in a series about the rail and trail. Clearly, the Santa Cruz Branch Rail Line corridor held promise. The question then was how to take advantage of those possibilities. Here's Linda Wilsheson again.
The first step that we determined was necessary was to buy the line. And the line wasn't really available to consider purchase. In other words, it didn't have a willing seller until after the Southern Pacific Railroad was acquired by Union Pacific, which happened in 1995. So 1996 is when we started having the demonstration programs. We also visited the new UP administration in Omaha, Nebraska in 1996. I don't think they really took us seriously at that point, but you know, we persevered. And Sam Farr got an appropriation from Congress for $1.5 million to help us pay for everything we needed to be doing around negotiations, because the way the budget is set up at the Regional Transportation Commission, most of the money goes to other agencies, in particular Santa Cruz Metro, the bus system. So nobody wanted to have, even though the RTC has authority to spend whatever it needs on its own planning and administration, none of the officials who sit on the commission, most primarily elected officials, wanted any money taken away from the funds they were getting. Yeah. So that was
understandable.
That was really the first indication that this was not going to go smoothly, because everybody's in competition for funds. And in that era, now there's quite a bit of money flowing for infrastructure for a couple of different reasons that we can talk about more. But at that time, we had the rail money, $11 million from the Proposition 116 that was passed in 1990.
And that was a very important inflection point in the rail story, right? Because people were actually saying, we want investment in rail.
Didn't every I? Single vote we have had here, every single one, and we used to have a running tally of these votes at the RTC. I don't happen to have it personally, but has always been way over 50%, not just like marginally 50%, for in favor of doing something with the rail line. Okay. So it also was, but Prop 16 was a statewide measure. So that was our county share because we don't have much population here. You know, the big metropolitan areas received lots of money for rail transit projects mm-hmm. from Proposition 116. But $11 million was like, okay, that's a start. And I knew we needed more money, but it was something we could leverage for other money. And in 2000, the commission approved the $10 million from the State Transportation Improvement Program. The California Transportation Commission approved it, but our county proposed it to match the $11 million for acquisition. So then we had $21 million in hand, plus the $1.5 million that Sam Farr got, so we could actually manifest this without taking money from anybody else locally. Mm-hmm. And eventually, under George Dondero, was the executive director then, they were able to purchase the rail line finally in 2012.
So voters in 1990 said, we'd love rail, and then what, some 22 years later, after a very complex process, that purchase of this branch rail line, it became the public property of Santa Cruz County, and that's quite amazing.
It is amazing.
It is.
And that's one reason why we're fighting over it, I think, is because it's such a valuable piece of real estate, and we could never have duplicated that.
Never. You know, because no. It comes with all the easements. It's just, it's right there.
Everything.
Just going through this highly, highly dense population. Everybody loves to talk about.
And you can just walk there. I mean, people are talking about the first mile, last mile problem. Maybe I'm jumping ahead here, but
go ahead. It's important.
But even supporters, certainly people who don't support doing anything on the rail line. Oh, how are we going to get, you know, from the rail line to where we're going? Well, most of the places people would be going are actually also near the rail line within the coastal corridor. Now, I'm not talking about Scotts Valley. You know, I'm not talking about Boulder Creek. Those are important, too, but they're dependent on the highway. So, our congestion is focused on the densest coastal area, right?
Yeah.
And most people around the world, again, when they access, rail transit or rail public passenger rail transportation, they do get there by public transportation, or they walk there, or rolling. I say walking or rolling because, of course, people can ride a bike or they have a wheelchair or a stroller or whatever, you know, that sort of thing. And these vehicles are the kinds of vehicles you can walk right onto.
They're beautiful.
Everything has to be
I've been checking
ADA
out these
here.
Systems all over the United States and Austin and in Ottawa. They're beautiful. Yeah.
Ottawa's been definitely a leader in the types of transit that we envision could work on our rail line. Mm-hmm. I'm not a fan of big passenger trains, and that's why when people talk about the train, I always kind of use the term, try and use the term tram or light rail or something that gets people down to the scale of what we
It's very friendly and beautiful and sleek and elegant, these vehicles.
And they'll be modern, and they'll be energy efficient. And you can walk to them or you can, lock up your bike there and they'll be accessible. You know, a third of the people in the county, and that includes children, don't drive. But it also includes teenagers and students and
elders and disabled people
and commuters who want to have a relaxing time when they're traveling. And by commuters, I mean, anybody who's going more than just a few miles. To me, it's always been kind of a no-brainer. But of course, manifesting is a whole different thing.
In case you have just tuned in, you are listening to KSQD and KSQT, Community Radio for the Monterey Bay. I'm Christine Barrington, and as Santa Cruz County embarks on its next steps for exploring the possibilities of electric passenger rail, I am presenting a multi-part series on the rail and trail. Tonight's episode visits some of the early history. We'll be right back after this short break.
Hi, I'm Bobby Bishop, host of Be in the Night, bring you the best I can with jazz, love songs, and soul. Join me on Tuesday evenings from 7 to 10 p.m., playing the classics straight ahead and introducing you to the latest artists and composers. That's Tuesday nights from 7 to 10 p.m. right here on listener-supported KSQD 90.7 FM, Santa Cruz.
Dazed and confused by current events, national and local? Well, have we got a show for you.
Saturday at 11 a.m., What a Week brings you a listener's digest of the news you need to know.
We scour the web, read the papers, and dive deep into what's happening in Santa Cruz to tell you what you need to know when you need to know it.
Now, you can't be well-informed unless you are informed well, and What a Week points you in all the right directions.
So join Tony Russomano
and Eric Nelson
every Saturday at 11 a.m. on KSQD 90.7 and KSQD.org.
What a week!
This train, the train, this train. This train is a clean train, this train. This train is a clean train. Everybody ride it in Jesus' name. This train.
Welcome back to Talk of the Bay on KSQD. This is the first in a series about the rail and trail. For many in the Santa Cruz community, it can be a confusion. When we're talking about the rail trail, are we talking about a trail or a rail, or is it both? Last year, I went searching for answers and met some wonderful folks along the way who have played different roles in the evolution of possibilities for the Santa Cruz Branch Rail Line. Former Regional Transportation Director Linda Wilcheson is understood to be a champion of rail, and she's taken her blows as champions often do. So I wondered, what inspired her committed vision around the rail line?
At one point, I think you asked me about what my vision was, and, you know, I know others have asked me about that, too. And, you know, my vision was developing during my time at the RTC, and I was part of a transit trip that was federally funded, and I was invited to go on this trip in 2000. And we looked at all different kinds of systems in Germany and France. That was the trip. These were systems like the rail line we had, so they were shared use systems between freight and heavier passenger rail and lighter rail, and they were using existing rail lines. So it was very much pertinent to our situation here in Santa Cruz. The outcome of that visit, and some people have characterized this, actually Fred Keeley has characterized it this way, as, you know, I saw the light on this trip. And, you know, it's really, that's really not true, because I was already in my own understanding and my own research of how we could make this work here. And then, remember, that's still when we had freight service on the rail line. We think we're unique in everything. We're not. I mean, there's lots of places where people were trying to repurpose resources that they have already, infrastructure that they already have, in particular rail lines, for people, because the traffic was intolerable. I mean, that's the situation that we had here then, and that's the situation that we still have here now. And that vision, though, was that vision that I will accept that was my vision, had a rail line as a part of it that was a functional, maintained rail line. Yeah. And we hadn't gone through all these many studies and many conversations and disputes and disagreements and, you know, what's the involvement of Metro. It was very clear, yeah, it should be run by Metro. Why? I mean, they run the bus system, they run the public transportation system. Of course they should run these rail cars too. That was the idea. And we don't need stations, no big stations. We need platforms. We can do it the way that fits within how we do things in Santa Cruz. That was the idea. Yeah, vision, and there was no trail that was part of it. That's the other thing. Mm-hmm. The trail became a part of the concept.
Right.
And in fact, on that trip in Europe, a lot of these systems had trails associated with the rail line. So, you know, it depended on how much room you had to be able to do that. I live about a block away from the rail line in Live Oak. I know and have known since we started talking about this how constrained the rail line is in some locations. And I believed then, and I believe now, that in those locations we need to route the trail off the rail line. I'm not sure that's what's happening with the planning now. I'm certainly way more than arm's length from anything that's at that level at this point. But part of the challenge we have now is fitting everything in. And I understand when people are concerned about that.
Fair enough.
Yeah,
so,
some
yes.
people believe there's always an engineering way around the constraint, and that's true. There is. We have a lot of development close to the corridor, and we have a lot of bike lanes and sidewalks nearby. So
right.
the issues have ended up being around this have ended up being raised with the trail development, not with the joint development of a rail and trail, which again was I had hoped was the way we could go.
Was really focusing.
I was counting on that was the way that we would go.
That we would focus on rail.
No, initially it was focusing on rail. Then it was like, oh yeah, let's make the trail work. But knowing that
where it's constrained, let's go around. Yeah. Let's figure out an alternate. Thank you for reflecting on your vision. What I'm hearing you say is that it was a dawning vision, a budding vision, an evolving vision.
Yeah, yeah. And of course, most of my time was spent on working with Caltrans on highway projects, Mission Street, the interchange of Highway 1 and 17, developing the call box program, instituting the Freeway Service Patrol and the Highway 17 Safety Program, working with the truckers who then, you know, because we had all these quarries where, you know, not only was the concrete was being shipped on the rail line, but all the rock that was needed for all this development that was going on in the Bay Area and elsewhere was driving in trucks over Highway 17. So this was one of many things we were all working on. You know, both the elected officials on the RTC and the commissioners and the staff.
And so you really helped move it forward, and then other administrations have taken it onward, and it's become bigger and more fraught for a variety of reasons since you left.
And
yes,
I didn't come into the job with being a train person, so I came into it really more from the political end, and you know, being an activist, a community activist, and being a planner and being a big picture person.
Mm-hmm.
And when you start looking at the big picture again, like we've already talked about, you have the highway here, you have the rail line here, you have a constrained corridor, you have development now constrained because of the Measure J that we passed in 1978. You know, like, okay, what can we do differently here? So it's not something that was, you know, I had a notion I was going to come in and buy the rail line and try and build a rail system. It really came from understanding how transportation worked and how it works together with land use.
So where in all of this did the trail option sidle up to the rail option and take its hand? Well, let's start with the big picture. Here's Congressman Sam Farr.
Well, my interest in rail and trail sort of got interested separately. I mean, growing up here on the Monterey Peninsula when I was a young kid, before we had freeways and a lot of superhighways, the way you got around was on rail. He went to San Francisco on the Del Monte Special, and he went to Los Angeles on the Daylight, you know, and then I was active in Boy Scouts and stuff like that and really got involved in outdoor camping and really interested in trails and discovery of areas. And when you think about it, the history of our region, the Monterey Bay region, developing these rail systems that the Southern Pacific did to get tourists to the Monterey Peninsula for the Del Monte Hotel that they built in 1875, and the Suntan Special that ran from the Pajaro Junction up to Santa Cruz, and then you had through the mountains a rail system. So, you know, our history is based on rail, and when you think about it, the rural areas didn't even have roads. I mean, you think of Big Sur and everything, it was all accessible only by trail. And sure, parts of Santa Cruz County the same way. So our history is both rail and trail. What also gave me really interested in getting that money for Santa Cruz was previously when the Southern Pacific started tearing up the rail line that went all the way to Spanish Bay and Pebble Beach, they had a commercial freight line that hauled the sand where Spanish Bay Hotel is now. It used to be a big sand operating plant, and all the sand was hauled out of there as it was in Davenport. So that sand plant was being abandoned. Pebble Beach was converting it into, you know, a destination hotel. So Southern Pacific started wanting to sell that corridor, and our local park district, a regional park district, came to the Coastal Commission and said they had no right to abandon the trail without environmental impact report and all of that. And then it ended up where Southern Pacific sold the rail line to the park district, which Now it's granted to the city of Monterey and Pacific Grove. But we have more people walking between Monterey and the wharf and the aquarium in Cannery Row and on to Pacific Grove than visit our number one tourist destination, which is the aquarium. That is, trails are the largest tourist attraction on the Monterey Peninsula. You know, that's big economics. And so I see the trail movement is huge. And what I fault is a lot of the cities and counties hire economic development specialists, and they're always trying to attract businesses to come move to a city or to a county. They forget that the best way to do economic development for small business development is building trails, because of all the interests in how you use trails with bicycles or horses or walking and so on. So the one thing you don't want to lose is a corridor once you have it. And the railroads built the first corridors, and we should be preserving those for opportunities in the future.
So trails, it turns out, are big business. People, it turns out, like to walk around, roll around, bike around, and basically enjoy life outside of a car. And it turns out where we live is the real treasure, and people want to experience it. Here's Sam Farr again.
And this was interesting. When I was chair of the Economic Development Committee in the legislature in Sacramento, I had the author of Megatrends come talk to us. And one of the things he just blew my mind, he said that the more money was being spent on wildlife watching than in all the sports, all the big sports in the United States. If you look at all the sales of outdoor equipment, you know, binoculars and sleeping bags and everything that gets people outside, it's all watchable wildlife. And when you come to the coast, what do they want to do? They want to watch whales. We're making more money off watching whales than they ever made off killing whales. Same thing with sea otters and elephants, seals, and things goes on. So watchable wildlife is what we in Monterey Bay have been able to preserve and give access to better than almost any other part of the state. I mean, a couple of things that I don't know a lot of people in Santa Cruz know. Do you have more mountain bike trails than anybody in the United States per capita in the amount of area? Santa Cruz is the smallest county in California. And you also have more access to the outdoors from where you have entry points to trails into the woods or along wherever they are than within 20 or 30 minutes of your house, more entrance points than any other community in California. So you are already endowed with incredible trail development, and it just makes sense to logically develop that same trail along the coastline. You really want to have sustain the quality of life that Santa Cruz so appreciates, and Monterey too, because I want that trail to go all the way around to the bay. I want it to connect from Pebble Beach to Davenport. I think it'll be the number one attraction in both counties will be the use of that trail. And it seems to me what we'd want to do is have it not all congested where everybody is in a parking lot or on a highway, but
right,
getting people out on their walking and biking and seeing and getting access to this stuff is that you spread that impact out where you can accommodate more people without feeling the hardships of it. So I just think these rail and trail corridors are our future and essentially built upon how we were all founded in the first place by rail and trail.
In case you have just tuned in, you are listening to KSQD Community Radio for the Monterey Bay. I'm Christine Barrington. This is the first in a series about the rail and trail. And in case you haven't picked it up yet, Sam Farr is a champion of rail with a passion for the trail. Linda Wilsheson is a champion of rail who understood the value of including the rail alongside it because people in the community wanted it, and after all, a trail is a transportation option for those on wheels and those on feet. So let's introduce a community member who has played a pivotal advocacy role for transit alternatives, especially for those on wheels. Micah Posner was executive director of People Power and then became one of the founders of Friends of the Rail and Trail. He also served on the Santa Cruz City Council and through that found his own unique pathway to becoming a small-scale builder of affordable housing. Because the evolution of the rail trail has been developing for decades, there exist many versions of its unfolding. Here's Micah's.
So there were, I think when you said, was it railroad trail, it's both true. So two things happened concurrently. So the Regional Transportation Commission, under the strong leadership of Linda Wilshenson, who worked for the commission, but she was really a creative visionary force, she wanted to do rail, right? And then simultaneously, a councilwoman named Stephanie Harlan from Capitola wanted to showcase the scenic beauty of the Monterey Bay. So she convinced Sam Farr to create the Monterey Bay Sanctuary Scenic Trail. And it was billed as a walking, biking way to enjoy the Monterey coast and see the scenic beauty. So Sam got really into it and he wanted to go fund it. And he was really good at getting money, especially back then when it was easier to get money. But essentially what Stephanie had in mind is like, if you travel around different cities or states, there's like signs that say, you know, special scenic trail. And then there's parts of it that you can walk like Westcliff, and there's parts of it that are just, you know, you're just driving along and then you stop and you get to another sign, you drive along. So it was going to be fluff, but it was going to be nice fluff. But then the biking community heard about it. So I was the director of People Power at the time. And People Power, it changed names like 5 or 10 years ago and kind of changed style to become Bike Santa Cruz County. It became much more mainstream. But People Power started during the first Gulf War in 1989. And it was a hard-hitting activist organization, keeping in mind that back then bicycling was like super strange, marginalized thing to do. Like when you'd ride around your bike, people would ask you if you had a DUI. Otherwise, why are you riding your bike? You're white. You know, it was like totally strange. So I was one of the founders of People Power, and then I wandered around and climbed mountains or whatever. And then I came back and I was the director of People Power from 2002 to 2012, approximately. So when I was the director, we heard about the Monterey Bay Sanctuary Scenic Trail. And we're like, fine, but let's make it for real. You know, let's like have a real trail that is actually a bike path and a walking path that goes all the way around the Monterey Bay. Somebody told us about the idea that, well, what if you put a trail along the rail corridor, you know? And at the time, converting rail lines to trails was very common because like in the Midwest and East, there's tons of like abandoned rail lines. But also there had been some rail with trail facilities. There was already one that had just been completed in San Diego, for example. So a group of People Power members got all excited about this and kind of formed a subcommittee. And we started interacting with the Rails to Trails Conservancy. And they were awesome. They gave us free information about how rails with trail systems work. So then we decided that the Monterey Bay Sanctuary Scenic Trail should occur on the rail line. And we started calling it the Rail Trail.
And so the vision for a combined system of a rail and trail took root and gestated, and gestated, and gestated. Because let's remember, transit years are stretched. If you are impressed with the ratio of dog to human years, well, transit system years stretch out over a decade. Here's Sam Farr.
I mean, I thought we could, I started this idea of doing trail around Monterey Bay way back when I was in the legislature in 1980 and working with Henry Mello on, and we were getting some money on that way back when. We both envisioned that all this would be done within the decade. now it like, and I doubt that much of it will be done in my lifetime. So I just want to see I want to see more progress. I want to see more, let's open up more, particularly in Santa Cruz, because you're way ahead of the game in Monterey.
It turns out that others in the community also felt the stretch of time. Micah Posner was one of them, and this led to an action that some may remember. You may have read about it when you opened your Sentinel on the morning of April 7th, 2004.
Fed up with a slow-moving public process, a group of shovel-wielding bike activists plans to make a guerrilla trail for bicyclists and pedestrians along the rail corridor. All this despite the fact that the Santa Cruz County Regional Transportation Commission doesn't own the land yet. It's part of a creative and thoroughly Santa Cruz campaign to get the rail trail up and going sooner rather than later. It's the obvious thing to do, said Mike Posner of People Power. Everyone's ready to build it. The government agencies that are supposed to do it can't get it together. But I'm getting calls from everyone, from wealthy developers to deadbeat college kids who want to show up and do it. Union Pacific Railroad considers any walking along the rail line to be trespassing. But, and I quote, we realize that Santa Cruz has a peculiar history in the scheme of things.
Here's Micah with the inside narrative.
You know, I was pretty young, and People Power, the whole thing about People Power was we were totally idealistic and out of the box and radical. So we started doing things to help people visualize the trail in a way that was forceful. Like, I knew all the difficulties of buying the line and building a trail, but we didn't talk about that with the public. We were just like, look, this is common sense. We should have a trail, right? So the most high profile thing we did is we started building the trail without permission, and we called it the Gorilla Trail. There's still a little bit of it down by the climbing gym off of Murray. For a long time, there was a big section over by Safeway on the west side, but that's now the real trail, which is awesome. So we mostly did a trail over by Seabright, and me and my buddy Jim were the guerrilla coordinators. It wasn't officially People Power Project. So we would call Central Home Supply, and they would come and dump decomposed granite near the tracks. And they gave us a nonprofit rate, which was pretty funny. And then we would show up with shovels and tampers and wheelbarrows, and we would just start building a trail in broad daylight, usually on a Sunday. And then people would see us, and they would want to help because it was such a great idea. Like, everyone's like, cool, yeah, we should totally have a trail here. And we would do some advertising, but it was before, first of all, we didn't want to, like, post it everywhere. And secondly, it was before the internet was so prevalent. So it was kind of like word of mouth, people coming by. And we ended up with a crew, like, every Sunday of, like, you know, 6 to 14 people. And my job was to go stop people and be like, hey, you want to help us? You know, because I like talking. And Jim was in charge of the actual construction. So we built kind of like about a mile of trail there, like from the river mouth to the bridge, the Murray Street Bridge. And then we moved to the west side, and that was much easier to build, and there were no erosion problems. We quickly built a trail on that section near Safeway on that triangle. And Union Pacific would call me, and I found out they had one enforcement officer for the entire northern part of California. Right. And they were livid. You know, they would call me and they'd be like, this is our property, you know, blah, blah. And we're like, it's okay. We're just making improvements, you know, and we were careful not to disturb the tracks in any way. And they tried to call the police. So the police came and they were like, what are you doing? This is UP property. Like, yeah, I know, we're just making a great trail. We're improving it, you know. And so the cop's like, that looks cool. You know, why don't you like flatten out those bumps? I'm going to get a cup of coffee and I'll probably come back in a couple hours. And we were making front page news. Like, you could do an archival search in the Sentinel because we were, you know, we were totally public about it. And in the meantime, in the back channel, I was hearing that the negotiators on our side were pointing out the liability issues, because even before we started building this trail, like, you know, there's all kinds of stuff going along the tracks. And that was probably the one reason for UP to sell it. So, but now the liability issues were huge because people were being encouraged to like build stuff on the tracks and walk on the tracks, right? And so that was starting to affect UP and they were getting nervous. And it was helping with the negotiations. So UP contacted the Surface Transportation.
Did this action actually encourage Union Pacific to sell the line? Well, it's hard to say, but it does paint a picture of how the forces working upon the rail trail project were filtering through the politics, the planning, and down to the people who were beginning to be ignited both for and against the rail and trail. The next year, Linda Wilsherson would step away from the RTC, and it would be another 6 years before the deal would close in 2012 to make Santa Cruz County owner and controller of that precious rail corridor. We are going to hear all about that story in our next episode, but let's return to Linda, who inspired, guided, and protected the rail project over her 20-year tenure, always holding the big picture for our region.
When you think of a transportation system in our community, I'm not talking about, you know, Munich here or San Francisco or, you know, Washington, D.C. or whatever, in our community, that would be an option for you listening right now, irrespective of where you live, having more ways to get around that aren't driving. So that includes walking or riding your bike or, you know, having safe places to do that. But it also includes being able to have a relaxing trip on a bus or a relaxing trip on a tram. If you're in Boulder Creek, now I know that's not going to be possible for you from your home in Boulder Creek. But if you're in Live Oak, which is where I live, it would be totally doable for me to get on the rail line and then take a bus up to UCSC if I wanted to go up there for, you know, an art show or something like that, or a lecture. And in fact, I hate going to UCSC because I hate parking up there. Example, yeah. I do take the bus to UCSC, but having that addition mm-hmm. to our public transportation system would really benefit a lot of people. Yeah. And we're going to need this. We're going to need it in the future.
Options.
It's we just need options. It. Well, we needed yeah. it 30 years ago.
We did.
So it's not just the future. We mm-hmm. imagine Beautiful. How things would be different now.
Yeah, I was thinking about seniors or disabled people that live along the line. How easy it would be to say, let's go into Aptos.
You know, go to a restaurant. There's a market there right along the rail line. There's a New Leaf. You could get
or
on
Capitola.
There. Capitola.
Right.
You can go to the store. You can go to all kinds of entertainment options. It would just improve the quality of life. So,
Remember, lots of people don't have a car. So it also...
And lots of people don't have a car.
And as our county ages, which I just heard this statistic that, you know, our county is aging faster than any other county in California.
I had not heard
you can
that.
See why, because people can't afford to live here. Younger families can't afford to live here.
Good analysis. That makes sense.
So, yeah. I mean, another aspect of the rail line that really nobody ever wants to talk about is that when you have an operating transit system that's a line, not a buses, because the great thing about buses is they can go all over the place. Wherever there's a road, usually, you know, they can go. But when you have a line, it's a good place to locate multi-unit housing and denser housing, which is what we need to be doing, as everybody knows, to be able to accommodate the population growth. And if you focus that development, and I know people don't like the word development around here,
But it is being mandated by the state.
We're in a different situation now. If you focus it along the coast corridor, which it is already, I think, being focused there, because that's where we have municipalities and urban development. People can have lives without spending it alone in their car when they have options about getting around, which everybody loves to move around. And everybody loves to have more of the way they move around, which is why people support widening highways and bike lanes and all that sort of thing. And your voice for public transportation is, you know, children, teenagers, older people, people who are disabled, and UCSC students and Cabrillo students to a certain extent, although most people drive to Cabrillo. They're the ones who are going to be served by both the housing and the public transportation. And I know to some people in our community, I mean, that's not a vision that appeals to them. But for people who have had an experience of, you know, livable communities concept, which was kind of faddish for a while, and then we started widening highways again, basically, is what happened. It's a much more companionable way of living.
And finally, it's not just about us, it's about all the human beings who wish to experience the place we call home.
Even though we're a small area, kind of isolated, urbanized area, we are on the coast, the California Central Coast. We have so many fabulous natural amenities here, and people around the world have heard of Santa Cruz, or they've come here, they've visited here, they know somebody here, they know about the university here. So it's not like we're a little urbanized area of 150,000 people where nobody even knows the name of our town. So that's why there's so much interest in doing something here that connects us to the rest of the world. And a lot of people in the rest of the world have these kind of options available to them. They have public transportation systems, and they appreciate places that, you know, would allow them to access the amenities that we have here without having to drive here. So that's another whole level of this. It's not just what it could do for our own commuters or our own people who, you know, live in Gilroy or live in Pajaro and work in Santa Cruz, but We're a part of the bigger world because of the nature of our area.
Santa Cruz is a world-class region. People will always be drawn here to live, to work, to play, and to be a part of its epic beauty. More people will seek to live here. More people will want to visit. The question before us is, will we integrate how we get around and find some flow, or gridlock ourselves? Sam Farr thinks the answer is up to you.
Well, look what Santa Cruz has brought to California. I look at Santa Cruz as the engine that roared, you know, the little engine that could, because you have this spirit of, we can do it, and you will, but we've got to get it more personal, and more people need to be involved and feel like they have ownership of the solution.
Woo!
Join me next week when we explore George Dondero's tenure at the head of the Regional Transportation Commission, where he led the effort to purchase the rail line and develop the award-winning Monterey Bay Sanctuary Scenic Trail Network Master Plan. This show features Sam Farr, George Dondero, John Leopold, Senior Transportation Planner Corey Coletti, Micah Posner, and more. I want to thank Sam Farr, Linda Wilsheson, John Brissenden, and Micah Posner for sharing their insights with me. We barely scratched the surface of these early years of the rail trail, and any storytelling shortcomings are all mine. Thank you to Eric Nelson for his music selections and to KSQD. This is KSQD, community radio for the Monterey Bay. Catch us on 89.5, 89.7, and 90.7 FM. Or live stream at ksqd.org.